All right, welcome. Congratulations on surviving all 4 days of DragonCon and being able to sit upright in the chair. We will not hold it against you if people pass out or fall asleep during here, but this is going to be a pretty lively and fun discussion. The way we're going to run it, we're going to start off with just a little bit of base information and get to as many questions, as much discussion as we can. We have an awesome panel here today. I want to let you know, if you've appreciated any of the tracks in the programs in the Apocalypse Rising track, please go to your app and rate these sessions. It has its big impact on the quality of TV guests we may be able to get, the panels you want to see next year. So please take the time to rate the track. It really helps out a lot, and we'll set things apart. So without further ado, we want to start off by introducing our awesome panel of experts. We'll start down on the end with Les.
Self-introduction? Okay.
Yeah, okay, good.
Yeah, hi, I'm Les Johnson. I live over in Huntsville. I'm a physicist. In my day job, I work for NASA at the Marshall Space Flight Center, where I'm the technical advisor for the Advanced Concepts Office. But I'm not here representing NASA this weekend, certainly not on this panel representing NASA. I also write science fiction books for Bayon Books and some popular science books. I gave a talk last year in the Apocalypse track about what would happen if we lost all our satellites. And it's a book I have called Sky Alert. And my most recent science fiction novel is kind of its own survival book. It's called Rescue Mode, and it's about a Mars mission. And what a realistic Mars mission where things happen in the 2030s or 2040s, and the people on board have to kind of ingenuity their way out of those dilemmas. And so today we'll be talking about the 4 years after, and I'm looking forward to it. Sounds like fun.
So my name is Doug Talk. I had 16 years active duty United States Navy, had a bunch of different jobs. I'm currently a physician, specifically I'm an OBGYN. My first time here on this track, this is going to be a lot of fun. Usually over in the space track, one of the jobs that I also do is I am a consultant for SpaceWorks Enterprises. We're actually working, some of you may have seen this or saw a mention of it, but we're working on a project to put astronauts into hibernation to send them to Mars for manned missions. So that's kind of my work with them over there. I was glad to be invited. It was a good mental exercise, you know. As doctors, I'll say it, I'll admit it, we've gotten kind of dependent on technology. I mean, you go to the doctor's office and what happens, you go to the ER and we stick you with a needle and run a bunch of labs and do an x-ray and a CT and EKG, and we have little electronic monitors that monitor your pulse. I mean, that technology's not going to be available. You know? So for me as a physician, it's a good mental exercise. How am I going to take care of people? Technology isn't around anymore. The pharmacy's not there. CVS is not going to be there.
Got a market for leeches.
Hey, we still use leeches, actually, in that. We can talk about that.
Awesome. So, I'm Richard Allstott. People call me Hawk. I've been worked for NASA. I've got 4 degrees in fire. It's a funny story. I've worked for NASA for 11 years. I worked for MDA for several years. I worked for DOD at present. I'm a contractor, not a Gubby. And of course, I am not representing government at any point here. I do radiation. It's my big thing. And I do survival for government systems under certain circumstances. So just assume that those, and we'll not talk about that, but we can discuss survival and how such things work. And you want to do a whole frontal statement here? I don't have a book. I wish I did. I'm still trying to get one in for today. I'm big on power supplies. The whole 4 degrees in fire is how to get power out of rocks or whatever, and it's really my focus on just about everything. Is everything's better if you can turn the power on. The big difference is, of course, you might also have issues with places where there have been incidences, so you'll have disease incidences and biological incidences and radioactive nucleotides. The Navy calls it sea burning, one of the survival issues we have to dig up, because some of those things don't go away. The classic would be anthrax. If I spilled some anthrax in here, you would sweep it up, and then you'd take up the carpet, and then you would bleach down the floors, and then you would burn all of the aforementioned items. Because in 50 years, if somebody didn't do that, and you came in here and you kicked the scuffed the floor, you'd get anthrax. not terribly deadly as diseases go, but there are some seaborne issues that just don't go away. So, so that's my specialty, your specialty, his specialty. So, if you have any other statements, we'll just go on to take questions.
So we have, as you can see, just awesome panelists. With the handout, we've got a list of all the panelists for all the tracks and links to any of their books, publications. So if you want to follow up, check them out on their websites. Please help yourself after this. What we're going to do is just want to set the stage on kind of what we're talking about when we say 4 years. Jump into questions. What I'll do is I'm going to keep a list of everybody in order. We're going to get through as many questions as we can. So make sure I acknowledge you. If I mess up and put people out of order, I apologize. We'll get to everybody. Both Doug and Hawk have to run immediately after the presentation. I'll be around after, less maybe, if you have any additional questions.
Before we go to questions from the audience, so let me ask a question just because we have these two experts up here. What do you think about where to go 4 years later? I mean, especially Hawk, as you're talking about power, one of the things I thought about coming in here is a book I read a long time ago, Mote in God's Eye. And it was Larry Niven and Jerry Cornell, and it was an alien invasion, and it was a different kind of apocalypse. But they went to a nuclear reactor and kept it up and running so they could rebuild civilization around that reactor. And I thought, that's not where I'm going to go, right? Because after 4 years, I mean, those reactors, you're going to have all kinds of problems after days and weeks, probably, around reactors if the water isn't replenished and the cooling ponds where the rods are kept and all that. So I started thinking, well, where would I go to rebuild civilization or try to have some kind of semblance of civilization? And I kept gravitating back toward near a hydroelectric plant. And so, you know, Hawk, since you're kind of the expert in talking about power, is that a good idea?
Yeah, well, okay. Frankly, my center of civilization is Chattanooga. Chattanooga is incredibly dense in terms of the things you want to have for a survivability situation. You've got rail lines. Now, sure, people can dig up rail lines, but in time, you can put them back, and they're a lot easier to put back than they were to lay across the mountain the first time. So I'm saying that rail lines is good. That means you have food supplies, and you have possibly coal, possibly. Nuclear power, I'm going to assume the guys know what they're doing in the plan. You can scale back your reactor to about a quarter power, and if you have, like, a base load that will run your base water pumps, like a TVA water system, then you could run that reactor for 20 years. It wouldn't be putting out as much power, but it would be possible to run it for 20 years on the fuel end. It would be tricky, but they've got nuclear engineers. That's what they're for. I happen to be one of them, and I wouldn't want to do the equations myself. And yeah, you could mess up, but that's the whole point.
but post-apocalypse, depending on what kind of the apocalypse is, you might not have the luxury of having the nuclear engineers around.
Well,
right?
That's the thing. That might get shut down. But TVA has the hydro power, it has coal power, it has gas power, it's got a lot of varieties right in there. So my besides, I like the weather. You get good food, and it's pretty easy to grow potatoes, tomatoes, and corn in that area, which actually also lets you have whiskey. Short list, but it's there. So I like the Tennessee Valley area for long-term survival in terms of, besides tornadoes, we don't get much in the way of earthquakes, drought. Is kind of mild.
The winters aren't too bad.
And the winters are not.
Yeah, so
not
that would be a plus.
But it's not the only place that's like that. It happens to be the only place I've lived that's like that. If you go much further east, Knoxville, about as far east as I'd go, that I would trust. The East Coast is going to get pretty poor.
And you've got a good supply of water in that area as well for drinking.
Oh, yeah, you've got sanitation. Water.
Yeah, I've noticed most of the people out west have to be really careful about their water supply. But I think they'll be dying soon. Survivalists all across the West. There's a lot of good areas out there, even if they're going to be low density. But for me, I'm trying to figure out where you'd be able to keep decent power supply. Wind power, depending on the type of apocalypse, you'd have to do a whole lot of scavenging from failing wind machines.
Yeah, because I don't think their lifetime is going to be like
their lifetime is 4 years.
Yeah.
So what you do is you yank them apart, you stop them. All but a couple, yank them apart and start using them as your supply thing. You get a good field out there with a couple 150 of them, say, and you're only trying to keep 3 megawatts going. And so you can keep 3 megawatts going by just keeping a few of them going and tearing the rest of them apart.
Well, my wife and I were recently touring the Hoover Dam, and the reason I thought of hydro is because we found out that the Hoover Dam is actually designed to last 1,000 years.
Right.
Okay? Wow. How many things in our modern world are having a design lifetime of 1,000 years? Not many things. And as I did some more research on that, I found out that if you can keep the pipes from getting clogged up by the mussels, the critters in the water, that the plant operates at a low level almost autonomously of people for generating power. So I started looking into that in preparation for today, thinking about hydropower. And if you can, you know, just get modest capability to keep it clean,
yeah.
You know, a hydro area sounds like the place to go if you want to keep the power on. And if we've got the power on, you have at least the potential of maintaining or rebuilding an early to mid-20th century kind of civilization.
And just to make it interesting, I'm going to be a little contrary to Paul here and say, you know, he thinks about Tennessee, and I think about Tennessee, and I just shiver because I think about ticks and fleas and
Tennessee's fleas
and nasty disease factors are very, very stuff like that. So, you know, kind of the same light, if you were going to ask me where I would go, I would go to Utah. Utah actually is the number one state in the United States that has the lowest infection rate of bacterial and viral diseases in the state of Utah. I don't know if that has to do with the Mormons or has to do with just how clean Utah is, but also Utah has a lot of resources. They have a lot of wind power. They do have hydroelectric. They have beautiful, if you've ever been to Utah, absolutely beautiful, beautiful natural resources available. So if you had to live out the apocalypse, it'd probably be a pretty nice place to live. And you're less likely to get sick. So
I would probably head towards it. It's a good point. I really don't think about disease vectors. Natural disease vectors often enough. But of course, I grew up there. It's kind of weird.
Well, do you think in the southern U.S. that malaria would come back?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Not just malaria, you got West Nile encephalitis, actually, you got yellow fever. Just get out, man. Walking Dead, why are you hanging out in Atlanta as a swamp? Get out! Go somewhere else, you know? Yeah, definitely get out of this. I can't even believe that we attempted to sit down as humans. You know, at least the Pilgrims had that right. It was cold in Plymouth, but man, they didn't have to deal with the mosquitoes. So.
Yeah, I'll tell you, when the French sold us Louisiana, they assumed we'd get nothing out of it. It's a place where Napoleon lost an army, and, you know, people die out there. Right. Just because.
As we learned, I mean, most of it is below sea level.
So. So excellent questions.
Yeah.
Questions.
Wow. Yes. So your experience is with radiation, right?
Mm-hmm.
After what we see in movies and games and stuff, like Blast from the Past, where 30 years after the fact that they think there's going to be a lot of radiation, if there was a thermonuclear war, how long would you have to worry about fallout?
Okay. I'm just going to posit an exchange with Russia, as was posited in the 60s.
And war days.
And, yeah, 70s. The stuff that's kind of what you call public exchange. Okay, so 30-some years later, what do you get? Right. Iodine is the first one. Cobalt-60 is the second one. There's a few heavy metals and what you call poison dust. Okay, so not to get into details, look for areas that have heavy metal poisoning. Late spring is the usual, so you look at the trees, and we usually take the pictures in infrared when we're trying to determine heavy metal poisoning, and you can see by the bright red colors when spring has occurred in an area in infrared, and there's areas that are just dead and brown, and you look at them normal light, and you're like, okay, those trees just aren't blooming very well. Okay, it's probably heavy metal poisoning. And after war, there's going to be areas where there's decent heavy metal poisoning because bombs produce a decent amount of crap. And that heavy metal, radioactive or not, is nothing to mess with. Professionals clean up mercury spills. Don't mess with mercury spills. It's simple. Iodine. Iodine luckily has a quick uptake into the environment, meaning for the first few years afterwards, this is the likely thing you're going to get exposed to is radioactive iodine. The iodine pills, if you think you're going to be exposed to iodine, take an iodine pill. The potassium iodate, that's about it. And that's good. Of course, you can't keep doing that, and you don't really want to do that your entire life. But after
you won't have a supply of it, probably, right?
Yeah. I mean, you've got a bottle, kind of like 60 to a bottle, that gives you a couple of months. And then Okay, so at that point, you start having to worry about animals that have taken up the iodine, like cattle. But anybody who eats grass is going to have that. And after a few years, it's out. It's gone through the environment. Yeah, there's going to be a slightly increased background level of radioactive iodine. But you're going to have to worry about thyroid cancers. But in general, that just means short people, and it's not normally fatal, thankfully. Cobalt-60 and cesium and some of the other medium long-lived radioactives are picked up in animals. They will be around for a long time. They're not terribly dangerous, but again, watch your consumption of meats. Pork in Germany is not dangerous, but they're still warning people about the cesium that the pigs pick up because they eat truffles, and that's a great source of radioactive cesium from Chernobyl. So, yeah, there are going to be some. The nice part is the Geiger counter finds all of it just fine. So if you check it with a Geiger counter and it's radioactive, it's an issue. And in meat, the general parts of the meat aren't going to be bad. Most of these heavy metals are picked up by specific organs. Uranium gets picked up in your kidneys, cesium gets in your liver, you get all sorts of these. You may have this list a little better off than I do. There's a book of it, and you can find the book on a lot of bookstores on radiation, health physics, is what they call it. And the problem is, of course, that's where the vitamins are, but unfortunately, those are just not going to be you check the organs, if they're hot, or if they're even mildly radioactive, because you don't really want the metals, they'll accumulate in your body too, just the same as they will in the animals. You're the apex predator. You'll accumulate all the heavy metals. So if you detect radioactive heavy metal in the organs of an animal, don't eat it. Toss that. It's unfortunate. It's a waste of natural resources, but that's just the way it's going to have to be. And over decades, the pigs are going to help you remove all the cesium from the environment, because the mushrooms will pick it up, the pigs will eat it, and you'll throw away the organs in a burn pile, and that burn pile will glow in the dark. But most of these things, there's areas, if you've got a Geiger counter, you stay out of blast areas where you've got ground that's highly irradiated. Highly irradiated areas, you have cobalt-60 that goes on for 15 years or so. At the 4-year mark, you're going to be watching it. And the other excitement would be disease vectors, because some of these are going to increase the rate of spread of things like a flu virus mutates at a given rate. I have no idea exactly what rate that is. But under a radioactive environment with a lot of spread, you might get a lot more cross transfers that are not properly vaccinated for already, right, and you haven't had any experience for it. So radiation zones aren't terribly safe, and they're not like you walked into it and you're going to die in 15 minutes and then Spock lives or anything, okay? But if you accumulate a lot of heavy metals in your organs, you're not reproductive material anymore.
I was just going to add, the problem with radiation is that, unless you're trying to fix the warp drive on Enterprise, you don't die from radiation immediately. Radiation is kind of a slow killer, and it causes, very small cellular changes, which causes mutations, which increases your risk for cancer and GI problems and things like that. So it's something you won't even know that you're in a dangerous place until years later, until it's too late. And just in case you're wondering, you don't have to actually own a Geiger counter. You can make one pretty cheap. Look it up online. It's like an aluminum can, two diodes, like a 9-volt battery, and some switches. It's actually pretty easy to make one. So you can make one. One of the things I was thinking about. Sorry, I didn't mean that. We're at the 4-year point now. Let's remember that too. We're 4 years after. So you can't just go like, oh man, let's go raid the GNC. Let's go raid the CVS, get some antibiotics. People have already done that. So is there anywhere that you could still go? Even a doctor needs supplies. Homeopathic doctors, we have all these great homeopathic medicines. Some of them are very good at very simple things. About ginger and garlic and all that stuff like that. It's very good for simple things, but you're going to need supplies. And the first two things that kind of popped in my head were prisons. Now, prisons is a great place to go. Most of you guys don't know this, but most prisons have a fully functional emergency room in the case of a prison riot, because they don't want to have to be transporting prisoners and guards outside the prison for medical care, they have a fully operational emergency room inside prisons. So that would be a really good place to be able to get resources. You know, people always ask me, you know, Dr. Berg, should I take this medicine? It expired like 2 weeks ago. You know, it's not like milk, right? Most medicines work long after their expiration date. They just maybe not be as effective, but they still work. So if my money was on one and you had to go rate one, go get amoxicillin. Amoxicillin is like the wonder drug. Amoxicillin treats Lyme disease, anthrax, and ear infections, and pneumonia, and UTIs, and chlamydia, and gonorrhea, because that's going to be going around. So, and you know, that, and the other place to go is pet stores. That's going to be the best place. You can eat dog food, you can take dog vitamins, you can use flea collars and flea meds to keep ticks and fleas off of you. And they also have some other medications too, so that would be another good thing. You can use fish filters to filter water. A lot of cool things about pet stores.
So Duncan, it's a good online resource, because one of the concerns that keeps popping up is, when do medicines go bad? Which ones become toxic because they become too strong? Which ones are ineffective and you have to up the dose? Is there a good online resource if people wanted to check their own medicine cabinets or print out a list in case of emergency?
Well, no, there's really not. I did a lot of that. I was looking through a lot of places. Any medical facilitated website is going to tell you absolutely not. Do not use any medication past its expiration date. But if you just Google, just Google real medicine half-life, just Google those three words, you'll come up with some really good sites of places that actually people have tested and how the effectiveness of medications kind of over longer periods of time. And pill medication is really stable, especially if you're in a nice, non-humid, stay out of the freaking East Coast, cool, stay out of the East Coast, environment. They can last a long time. And then the other thing I would tell you to do is go to universities. Go to colleges, raid their libraries. They have such cool resources, books 200 years ago. I mean, I have a Grey's Anatomy book from 1901, and it's got some amazing information on it. Pictures of plants and homemade remedies. And you know, I mean, think about it. For 4 years, nobody's going to be getting a vaccination. You know, measles, mumps, rubella, whooping cough, all of these medical problems that we don't have to deal with anymore are going to be back, and they're going to be back in a vengeance because we have no herd immunity to it.
You know, I think raiding a library is a good reason, or protecting a library is a good reason for a lot of this, because this is 4 years later, you're past the immediate crisis, you're trying to rebuild. You know, if you've got a doctor on hand, and you've got, you know, some kind of semblance of a civilized group or a town or whatever where you have agriculture, and you've got a little bit of power, you want to preserve as much knowledge as you can preserve. And you want to keep the people who don't have that, who are probably raiding and not caring what's there, from destroying that knowledge base. So I would say raiding a library or protecting one is a really good idea.
So we've got five questions now queued, so let's jump over to those. Gentleman in the hat from the back.
I was just wondering what infrastructure will last and how long will last, be it power or just even water systems.
Water systems are an actually good question, because older water systems and water systems in mountain areas are often free flow. Yeah. So you can leave them alone and very little will happen. If you live in LA and you use pumped water systems, the answer is when the lights go out, don't flush the potty.
Right.
Because the potty ain't going anywhere. It's going under the house where it's going to sit in a nice flat pipe that will never, ever flush unless there's a rainstorm. Okay, so occasionally everything flushes in LA and it all gets into those big, big basin things that run down the lake. But no, in general, older, there's a lot of free flow water systems, which are essentially permanent. I think so. One of my cousins-in-law, I just went to a family reunion in Ohio, West Virginia, and he's replacing the lead pipes in his house. His house was built in 1870-something, and it was built with leaded pipes, and he's having to replace them because there's some spots where they started to leak, and he figured he might as well change them out. Not that they were failing, just that he decided it was about that time.
Well, I think maintenance is the key to a lot of this, because some of these systems are pretty complex and high-tech, and you can't maintain them if civilization's gone. But a lot of them are not. and you can kludgeon and you can maintain it. The problem is if you let it go and you try to rebuild it, that's really hard.
Can you imagine snaking without power tools?
And even, you know, just in terms of maintaining where you're living, you know, that leak, fix it immediately. But however you fix it, it's going to cause all kinds of other problems. So it's going to be a diligent effort just to maintain as you go.
And Hawk, you know, he brought up a great point. I just recently went to Yosemite, and if you've ever been there, you can see on the mountains they have these huge, pipes, and literally they're just for snowmelt, kind of redirecting water. And those things have a long life. I mean, think about it. Does anybody know when Rome officially stopped using Roman aqueducts as a source of water?
They
haven't. They haven't, right. They still are some places that use original Roman aqueducts for water. So those are 2,000 years old, and they're stone. So, I mean, 4 years later, these pipes will still be working.
And in terms of buildings and such, one of the things I found doing research for today is older buildings that are stone, that are basically made out of simple materials, not always great man-made materials, they're going to last a long time.
Yeah, if the all those shelters, the severe weather or weapon shelters, the nuke shelters under some of those buildings, the standards those were built to are quite good.
World War II Army bases?
Yeah. The only thing you don't want to do is ever have to dig into that floor. If you ever have to break that concrete, go get the dynamite, because there's no power tools that are going to break it. If you don't have power tools, it's just not set. It's just stupid how hard they've got. They've got quartz concrete that they've used for the linings of these severe weather shelters. That's to make them harder in case of a blast. And it's incredibly expensive concrete. It's not very breakable. And then brick itself, while it's very crushable, it makes a great shield and it lasts a long time. Of course, once you break it, it does break. I mean, it just crushes right down. But until somebody actually puts something through it, it lasts pretty well.
So you had a question? Roger?
Following up on the radiation question that you were talking about, if a new kid has a brain here, how far out? 30 miles, 50 miles?
Okay. To be honest, that is my day job, and I could tell you fairly accurately. The difficulty is, what nuke? I would have to posit something that I'm not allowed to posit to tell you that. The important part is, let's just say big, because you don't really care if it's a little one, okay?
You do.
I said, the destruction radiuses that really, really turns out to affect us the most is the thermal. The light shining off this goes out for 10 kilometers is a reasonable number, and I wouldn't look at it from 30 kilometers if it's a big one. For a small one, you can look at 10 kilometers, okay? But you're going to be setting fires to every exposed surface that is flammable 10 clicks out pretty easily. And depending on the blast front, the wave front, the airflow outward, which is going to be a 30 mile an hour to 70 mile an hour wind flying out, you're going to create a firestorm that runs out to 30 kilometers. So, if it hit here, this place is gone.
There's a really good video called Trinity and Beyond. It's a documentary about all the above-ground nuclear weapons tests and how they constructed cities. Blew them up, and you can find this out there. And I recently rewatched that, and it's one of those things that you watch and you see the destructive effects to give you an idea of the scale of during the above ground nuclear tests. We tested bigger and bigger bombs of different types, and you will come away from that with a real appreciation of just how bad it
was. Yeah, there was another video too where they used London as its source. I'm trying to remember what it was, and they kind of gave it. They used different points of London, even landmarks, and stuff like this is a media effect here, this is a media effect here. But you know, the other thing to think about too is. And not just the initial blast, but the long term after that. I mean, if you look at Hiroshima and Nagasaki, they still have a higher baseline radiation level than other areas. They still have higher instances of lymphoma and kind of other radiation related cancers.
On Hiroshima now, it's a very small bomb. And you basically, the people who live downtown have a higher leukemia and lymphoma rates. The books to read, which are unclassified, in fact, we use these as the unclassified reference. If it's in these books, it's unclassified. The Effects of Nuclear Weapons, it's a 1970s book, and it covers the Hiroshima stuff pretty well. And EM1, which is the Effects of Nuclear Weapons, or I don't know what's the real name, EM1,
And it's half of that book is classified and half that book is unclassified. But the unclassified is available on the web. I have it very available. We're about to produce EM1 Chapter 14. Paul Drake is the Govey guy. He's doing it. He's a doctor and he's doing the human effects. And it's a chapter that would be a book all by itself. And it's going to be unclassified. The last time they upgraded it was 10, 15 years ago. So it's going to be a nice new chapter on human effects. And anything I say comes out of that book. Because if it is, I can't say it.
Hey, Hawk, I've worked for NASA for 25 years, and that's government side. And I've never before heard anyone call me a Govey. just saying.
They have Govies, they have Govies and civvies. And
oh,
they,
wow.
They have,
okay.
They have a really, you know, the soldiers.
That's a term I haven't heard. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. Question for her.
One thing that hasn't been mentioned a lot is how to resupply certain clothing. Because shoes and socks, underwear,
leather.
It's popular in some groups.
That's a very niche word.
It's con, though. I don't know their underwear around here, right? Clothes. You made it. Okay, so John Ringo, his book, The Dark Tide Rising, the zombie book. Mm-hmm. They come across a crate of dresses from Paris. You know, it's the last Parisian dresses. So they rescue them for the last ball ever, because they'll never be Paris again. You know.
What really changes your viewpoint on this? I heard a thing on NPR recently about used American clothes and which ones bring a premium for sale in Africa. Mm-hmm. You know, it was tracing what you take to Goodwill and how it ends up in Africa. And basically, we Americans buy it for style and all this other stuff. They go through the used clothing market there, and it's all about durability. And, you know, it's going to change your view of the clothing you wear dramatically here to go down. So
I do a medieval reenactment, and a friend of mine came across an 1890 bolt of cloth that, he was building a doublet and got it, and it was white. And so they used a hand dye. You could find some. It was a red, and I think it was based on nuts and flowers. It was a recipe that was in the George Washington's cabinet book. And so they did that recipe, and they colored it red and built a doublet out of it. And the cloth is, I have no reference here of how thick the cloth is. It's like you put three or four shirts together to make it. And of course, he hand stitched it, but they're using a reference that it was hand stitched. And it's, and this is colleges and other things, and there are people who have looms. I don't know who in this room might have a loom. I happen to know people who have one because they're weirdos who do medieval reenactments. I know people who treat leather. I know people who are just reenactors who like treating deer hides. I buy from them because I don't like to mess with the chemicals. But I do know that there are people out there who know how to make a deer hide and go from deer to clothing. I know people who know how to go from a sheep to a shirt.
But if we're talking about just the 4-year point, and if it's an apocalypse and a lot of people are dead, you're probably not going to have to yet worry about the clothing and the shoes thing, because you're going to have a lot to scavenge.
That's a
that 4-year point. And
if a lot of that is extra wide size, 10 and a half extra wide, that's going to be an issue.
Unfortunately, it's a lot of food.
So the 4-year point, I don't know if that'd be the top of my list to worry about at the 4-year point. Yeah, maybe at the 40-year point, but not the 4-year point.
Sooner or later, all these cheap American clothes will fall away, and you're going to be limited to, and people who know how to go from cheap to shirt.
But you mentioned on something that's really important, which is when your commonplace for getting clothes isn't available, and you think industrial fabric production isn't going to be likely either, going to schools, going to museums, other places that may have some of the more earlier devices, is going to be that secondary scavenge to look for the tools, to find the books, and to learn how to do that.
So this is my tragedy. The worst thing in the world is that I love this thing. It's not long for this world once the power goes out.
No more cat videos.
So,
thank you.
So anyway, when it comes to rebuilding our computer systems, the current market, and I have to deal with this on a regular basis,
we're going down to these 90-nanometer parts and they're being built in facilities larger than downtown Atlanta. Not joking, the warehouse where they do the majority work in downtown Atlanta and Snow Mountain is huge. There's a warehouse there.
But see, you're not, that's what I think where you're going is you're not going to be able to rebuild the computer.
Samsung's campus is bigger than the entire metro Atlanta area.
Yeah, you're never coming back.
But I think you could, if you keep the juice on, and you have good doctors with you,
okay,
and scavenge things, I think you could rebuild an early 20th century
building. I happen to know that the college at Georgia Tech has a chip manufacturer on site. Now, it's not nanometer scale, it's millimeter scale. So you're back building 1980s computers and 1990s computers, but they're available. And I don't say that you're gonna, nobody in this room, including myself, is ever gonna be building computers, unless you do this professionally for Samsung. Unless you are, you're never gonna do that. But people can learn to do it again.
Well, this would be a good question for Les, too, because our phones don't work like this, right? Our phones bounce off things and come back. So, I mean, you kind of addressed this before with your book, but like how, without support, how long is that satellite infrastructure gonna last?
Well, cell phones, of course, if the juice dies, you're not going to have cell phones at all.
So you only had electricity.
If you had electricity, you still wouldn't be able to use the cell phone network because you'd have to power each of the towers. I guess you could for a while, maybe.
Right.
It depends on where all the central switching stations are and all that.
There's point-to-point phones, and so you can reroute. So you can
walkie-talkies would still be good. CB radios you might still be able to use. You'd go back to more of the point-to-point communication.
I would think that's last year in your satellites thing was, we don't realize how reliant we are on satellites.
That's right.
Like Family Dollar. Can you share a little bit about that?
Well, sure. This book came about because of a trip to our local Dollar General market. And just to try to condense a whole hour talk down to a couple of minutes, it basically, I discovered as a NASA employee that basically we've won in terms of becoming, making space a part of our everyday lives. And I would contend that in your everyday life, you touch 20 to 50 satellites during the day. For everything from your news broadcasts, when you make a call on your phone, each cell phone tower has to have a GPS attached to it because they put timestamps on the data stream that comes out of your phone. That's how they route it from place to place. Without GPS satellites, your phone, your cell phone call won't work. Even though your cellular call itself doesn't go to the satellite, the GPS depend on that. Food going into New York has 3 days of food at any given time. And at night, the streets are given over to trucks bringing in food. And that's all controlled. It's all controlled centrally, just-in-time inventory management, satellite link for inventory management, for navigation, everything. So, even a minor apocalypse, okay, where you just lose, and my contention is if you just lose satellites, I would contend that lots of people would die. It would not be the end of civilization. In the worst case, a lot of people would die, probably tens of millions of people would die from the food infrastructure not getting up and running again fast enough, all the way to just a major depression, at the least, it would happen.
I mean, it would be reset in 1970.
It would, and our systems are not there to reset. So it would be a major disruption, and it wouldn't end civilization, but it would knock us back 50 years and lots of people would die. But the flip side of that is, as a space advocate, hey, we've won. the goal of space advocates was let's make space part of our everyday life. Well, it's now so much part of our everyday life that our civilization can't go without it. So, I try to be an optimist. We're going to survive the apocalypse. There's always a good side, but, that bad side, you got to be aware of it.
Yeah, that's
it. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
You mentioned earlier, on the topic of medicine.
Yeah.
How difficult is it to manufacture your own antibiotics?
A little harder than meth.
That is surprisingly easy to make, actually. The easiest antibiotic to make is penicillin. You make penicillin probably every about 4 days. She's nodding because she knows you don't take things out of the refrigerator, right? So they make penicillin a lot of times. It's basically a mold-based antibiotic. So that's pretty easy to make. The problem is that we as doctors give you antibiotics for, if you just ask for it, it's like, I just want an antibiotic. Or, sure, here you go, here's an antibiotic. So most things have become resistant to basic antibiotics. And the other thing, too, is surprisingly, human beings now have a high allergic reaction rate to penicillin. It's become one of the most common allergies, so you have to deal with that whole thing, too. So, right, exactly. So penicillin is the easiest one to use, but it's going to be the least effective. So that's going to be a problem. You're thinking about medicine, and you're thinking about the cell phone, too. And it made me think of I don't know if you guys saw the TV show Revolution, but it made me think of a scene. I probably own maybe 10 pictures of my kids. You know, all the other ones are on here, right? You know, I mean, like all your memories are all electronic now, and you would lose all that. But then it made me think of my kids, and it made me think about something else too. There's one medication out there that nobody is going to grab, which is vitally important with a very long shelf life: birth control. All right, yes. Nobody's going to grab birth control. It's a wonder drug. Not only does it prevent you from getting pregnant, it stops menopausal symptoms, it stops abnormal bleeding, it's protective of cancer, it stops pelvic pain, endometriosis, and also a fantastic medication. And, I mean, what was the number one cause of death in women up until the 1800s?
Childbirth,
right? You know, I mean, that was the number one cause of death. If there's a zombie apocalypse, what's going to be the number one cause of death of women? Being eaten by a zombie. But after that, that's going to be childbirth. So if you can control that, then that's a, if you can work birth control, you'd be a
the guy on the block. You know? Hey, ladies, I'm
we had a question far back left.
Yeah, I wanted to mention one caveat. We're talking about that medications do work after their expiration date. Some of them work too well.
Right.
And would there be listings of which medications would become more potent? Because that would be particularly there.
Yeah, no, and kind of in that same vein, they do. There's a couple of doctors out there that do some really good jobs, kind of, because there's really a push. You know, one of the things that I'm really happy to see now, this is kind of a little bit of tangent, is that patients are so informed now. You know, patients come in and basically tell me, like, this is my problem and this is how I want you to treat it. And most of the time they're right, sometimes they're wrong, and it's okay. We have a good discussion about it, and they're pretty open. But if you're open with them and have conversations with them, patients are very informed now. So doctors are really trying hard to keep patients informed and talk to them about how to use medication and home remedies, and I'm happy to recommend home remedies. I mean, you know, you'd be surprised how many medicines come from normal things. You chew some willow bark, right? What's willow bark?
Aspirin.
It's aspirin. I mean, Native Americans were doing that for thousands of years. I mean, even, you know, quinine, it comes from a tree, right? It comes from the bark of a tree. It's fever tree. Fever tree is actually the name of it. English yew actually makes Taxols. Taxols are chemotherapy drugs. A lot of the medications we use are actually naturally based. And if you can find those formulas, you can get some benefit.
We had a question, Mr. Hawaii. Sure.
Two questions. One, you've both been talking about things that are almost point events, and then the event itself goes away and leaves repercussions. How about events that get worse as they go along, such as
a bacterial,
event, civil unrest, hyperinflation? And also, I think you're somewhat pessimistic about computers, in that the infrastructure, a lot of that stuff is gone, but the research disappeared. What's slowing down a lot of things now is research. Well, to catch up to where we are now, you don't have to redo the research.
That's true. You don't have to redo the research, but there's the cost to develop something is pretty huge. And again, in long-term events, in a war, you know, if you could count on the war being over, but you're right. I mean, a war could last for, obviously, if you live in the Middle East, okay, God, we do not, but 20 years from now, it could still be the same fight going on over, you know, Chattanooga or water rights in the southeast or, you know, I can't. Obviously, we could talk about that forever. If there's still war going on, the main issue of staying fed and for the civilians is staying fed and staying with the lights on, because that's how you keep decent medicine. And the soldiers, saying this pretty directly, they want the same exact thing you want. They want a civilian base, because without it, they don't have food and supply. Supply is 9/10 of soldiers. So in most of these cases, and of course if it's a medical event, then it comes down to keeping the hospitals alive, to keep the soldiers alive, to keep the population alive, to keep the power on. And there's a unit there that all works together. Supply is based on having a functioning society. And so functioning society works to provide the protection for that functioning society. We've lived in silly season here since the 70s. Nobody thinks that anything bad could happen to the United States. I mean, the worst that could happen is maybe you get robbed sometime. And yeah, people get murdered and stuff, but it's such a tiny, tiny fraction of people, most of us go through our lives without saying anything would be real violence, okay? Chance of death. So we spend our time worrying about microaggressions and the cost of milk, when what really should matter is the fact that nobody is shooting us and we have milk. When there's a war on, those things may go away. And what will be important is the fact that we're not dying of some exciting new disease that's been imported from Africa and irradiated. And okay, so Ebola turned out not to travel too well, thank God. And it was easily contained. Mm-hmm. AIDS was really easily contained. Mm-hmm. So now we're to the next one. What's the next one going to be? I don't know. But there's somebody out there. And sooner or later, there'll be another disease, which is less easily contained than the first two. And maybe there'll be wars. And then the diseases get out all over the place, which they always do. So in a long-term event, I think the core element is keeping defended, survivable areas. And
what you do is going to depend on the nature of what that event is. You know, if it's a nuclear war, it's going to be different than if it's a biological kind of thing in terms of how people group together or how they work that survival strategy. So part of it, if it's a one-time event versus an ongoing event, so there's so much of what we talked about that, like you said, probably assumes like a single event you're rebuilding. You know, everything changes if it's an ongoing event.
Right.
You have to tailor your situation to what that event is.
But still, it comes down to keeping the lights on, keeping the medicine flowing, trying to keep your semblance of civilization going. And there are ways to do that. And when there isn't, when the power goes out on your electronics, when the satellites fall out of the sky from something, then you're going to have to come back to the next level of technology, drop back to the 70s, drop back to the 40s, drop back to the 20s, whatever it takes to keep, you know, you've got to get a horse and start plowing the fields. Because there's got to be food on the table at the end of the year.
But see, I keep going back to this. If it's a major event and you've got a pocket of civilization, the first thing I'm going to do is try to figure out how to manufacture the machine tools to make more copies of themselves and rebuild at things at the point where you have a sustained rebuildable civilization. The plant will eventually expire, you know, or otherwise. So I think we have to focus on making sure we have whatever we do is sustainable. And in a different sense than we talk about sustainability today.
Really, you know, the worst case scenario for a long-term event is probably a biological event. I mean, you guys know that people still die from the bubonic plague, right? There's a couple of campers in Yosemite that die from it. The end of the specters never go away. So there, the good news is, though, is that biological events are self-limiting. We all have that friend, like the jerk, never gets sick, right? He's always like, that's awesome. Never gets sick. And, you know, everybody's susceptible to disease, but not everybody's going to die from it. You can have an immune response and protect yourself from it. And so it's going to wipe out a large portion of the population. But, the best analog, look what happened to, the Incas and Aztecs. South America, the Native Americans in North America. I mean, Cortez didn't conquer that whole area with 100 men and, you know, 6 rifles. He conquered it with measles. You know, he came in and gave that population all these diseases they had no protection to, and it decimated them, but it didn't destroy them. Those populations still existed, just on a much smaller basis. So we'll survive that. It's just, you know, the degree. It's trying to save our own butts. That's what we're always trying to do here in mass infections. You know, not trying to save the human race.
Ma'am, you had a question?
When you're talking about the Southeast, one reason why I would actually go to the Southeast is the growing season here is phenomenally long. Water is readily accessible. And to me, I was born in Utah. I love Utah, but I am not trying to wade through snow for 6 months a year.
Yeah, it's a good source of water.
Yeah.
I really like
it.
I think
a big thing of the overall picture is skill sets. You've got to have skill sets that people are going to need,
right,
so that you can get what you need.
Right. Yeah, I mean, and at the 4-year level, though, you're actually going to be building new skill sets.
Exactly.
Because, you know, say I'm a computer scientist, engineer type. And we come out, and it turns out we're going to have to go back to 1920 for one reason or another, and we're going to be, you know, harnessing the mules to plow. I happen to know somebody who trains mules around here. I'm going to, you know, snag her and get some plow mules, and you know, I'm going to start having to train on, you know, a whole new layer of technology because my layer of technology is no longer the operation.
Right. But how are you going to pay that man for that mule?
JC, that's going to be an interesting
question.
Although
there'll be a lot of skill set bar.
Exactly. Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
You know,
the more
luckily I'm just beautiful,
have,
I'm just going to...
that's a good point, too, because it'll also, you know, the reevaluation of skill sets. I mean, right now, neurosurgeons are the bomb. Uh-huh. They're badass. They're useless in an apocalypse. Nobody's doing brain surgery, right? Well, you would rather have an ER doctor or a nurse or a midwife than you would have a neurosurgeon. They're going to be used to it. No offense to any neurosurgeon. But without the technology to support it, they're worthless as medical providers. So
big laser shooting robots.
Yeah,
it's like when you were talking about leather, you can tan leather with acorns.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's going to be skills like that are going to be.
So one of the things that we discovered on the 4-week panel is without lone wolf isn't going to make it 4 weeks unless they're just really lucky. You have to have some sort of a group, neighborhood, some community to collectively survive. Talk a little bit about what that might look like in 4 years. What types of communities, what size? I know it'll vary depending on the vector or the danger. Do you think we'll have functioning local government? Will we have high-functioning dictatorships? What are your thoughts on what type of community and structure, government structure?
Well, if I think about a true, massive disaster where there's been a lot of people dying and the infrastructure is gone, I don't think you're going to see cities of 50 to 100,000 people make it. I think even if people group together, it's going to be smaller groupings, maybe hundreds or low number of thousands who get together to survive at that four-year mark. And I think in terms of government, I think we could preserve some sense of self-government with that here. I think that's doable. I don't see us immediately going to some kind of totalitarian dictatorship. I think in the short term, you're going to have the natural leaders step up and people are going to follow them, but they'll very quickly want to reestablish some kind of, hey, wait a minute, I have a voice too, kind of thing. And where they are unsuccessful in that, that's where you're going to have to worry about conflict, because those are going to be the groups that are going to be the predatory groups, in my opinion.
I mean, I disagree just a tiny bit, but I agree in the long run. But what's the first thing we do when there's a disaster? Right, we declare martial law. The government loses a little bit of its control, the military or the police. Just as a member of the military, my natural response in an emergency is to take charge and to tell people what to do. As a doctor, if there's an emergency, my immediate response is to take charge, to people what to do. I don't want to listen to other people tell me. Well, let's think about, no, just do what I tell you to do, and let's get through this, and then we'll talk about it after. So initially, you're going to have these types of people stepping forward and taking charge. But this is what Les said. It's when you get to that point when the initial emergency is over, and now everything's starting to normalize, are they going to cede that power back? Or are you going to form some kind of government? I think in America, we would do that, because we don't put up with dictators. There's going to be certain sects in America that kind of view and need that kind of dictatorship. So I think you'll have different types of
stuff. It has to do with the military formation in the U.S. It's relatively libertarian. Mm-hmm. Most military has very little civilian control.
Right.
And it isn't really designed around it, except for emergency services. And, yeah, I think we're going to have to fall back. A successful area will have a large National Guard and possibly direct military presence, because I think it's necessary. And well, in terms of predatory groups, you're going to want to have a trained,
absolutely,
military group. I want a unit of U.S. Army on there. If somebody's trying to kill me, I'd rather have the professional killers on my side.
But like Doug said, I think at the 4-year point,
we're going to have to have some
kind of whoever those group of people are going to have an awfully strong desire to have some sense.
And I don't know any colonels that want to run anything. colonels, by and large, you have to understand how much effort it is to run army. It works, but the officers have a hell of a lot to do with their people, and they usually take a whole lot of responsibility for it. And their little sets, they move. They really make a lot of effort to make sure the majors don't sit in any one place any length of time. They want to give them lots of different areas of expertise, and they just don't want them to feel like they have a little kingdom. So by the time you get up to the colonel level, in general, you've got this paperwork tree that you've got to handle, and you're happy to push off things. If it's not under your purview, they just usually just go, you guys handle it,
And in these small groups, you're also going to have the people who wield the unofficial power. Those are going to be the influencers that you refer to, the people who know how to get things done and can solve the problems.
Yep.
And I think at the four-year point, that they may be the soft power behind everything because they're going to be the ones kind of figuring out how to do things.
Deputy, you had a question?
I was going to ask, this is about satellites. So let's say something happens on the ground, but the satellites are okay. How long will GPS actually function when it's not being maintained?
I mean, probably tens of years. I mean, they're designed to have multi-decade life.
Will it still be accurate for that kind of life?
There are, in large part, yeah, a lot of that can be done autonomously. Some of these have intense ground control. I don't know about GPS specifically because I'm on the civilian side. But a lot of our satellites will mostly autonomously operate for years. They will eventually run out of propellant for attitude, orbit adjustment, that kind of thing. But if you had a way to communicate with them, preserve that, I would think you'd be able to maintain that for a while. Unless something happened to knock them out, which is very different than something localized on the ground and they're untouched. Yeah.
It's always been curious about how long everybody's little navigate, because nobody has paper maps anymore.
Oh, no. And the stuff in low Earth orbit's going to fall out and stop functioning a lot faster, but even the really expensive, really well-maintained military satellites, after 25 years or so, they're gone.
I know. And you're going to have to be back to being in the wagon with your wife going, will you just ask for directions?
Some of us have paper maps, though.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, back.
I was going to throw one other thing. I was trying to work out a way to keep the ISS up for 4 years. It was not working very well. Because it's going to be dropping in altitude, and also the fact that the people on board, assuming you could eject most of them with Soyuz, if you had a couple of guys trying to live on 7 years people, 1.5 years food, let's see. So
they could stay up there if they put my electrodynamic to the reboost that I keep talking about.
Or if we put in the hibernation.
Do they have the ion thing going yet, or was that still too arky?
Electric propulsion on the station? Not yet.
Okay. It was giving them some fits before, and the SEDs they didn't like because the whole fishing line and astronauts thing, which I think was just totally ridiculous. We can use a couple of astronauts. Anyway,
I wouldn't say that.
I'm just being.
Far back?
Well, it depends which kind it is. If you know how to use it, the two best ones to have would be the Implanon or the IUD. The Paragard has no hormone at all. It's copper. It's got a 10-year in-uterine life, so it's good for 10 years inside the uterus, exposed to biological activity. Outside of it, it would last as long as copper lasts. It lasts 50 years. The Implanon is hormone, but it's sealed in like polyethylene and kind of slowly leaches out. Those would be good. I would still use one. I would be comfortable using one 10 years after its expiration date. The oral contraceptives would still be reasonably effective. They probably wouldn't be 99.9% effective, but they'd still be reasonably effective even 5 years after expiration date. It's a staple. I don't want to tell you what this one you freak out, but it's horse estrogen. You guys know that, right? It's just kind of a staple composite of horse estrogen. It would be effective. It wouldn't be 100% effective, but it would be effective.
Ms. Stormtrooper?
Hey, I actually kind of have two questions, if that's okay. The first one's easy. How long can we expect, AA batteries in the pack that you can just go pick up at the store to last with us? They'll be around in 4 years?
Ten years.
Are they no good?
Most of those are shelf stable.
Years. At the 4 year mark, you can still scavenge and use them. Okay. Absolutely.
I have three boys. I need like 9 million.
Right,
His house can keep scavenging till forever.
The new lithium ones last forever.
We don't like to talk about it a whole lot, but you look around society and you see uncivilized societies, women do not tend to be protected. So, is that some? What do we need to do?
In the last ship, it was running the entire city of Annapolis.
That's great, but in America, we really don't talk about this because we like to pretend that we have completely equal rights and everything is fine, but in the breakdown of civilization.
Well, do women still have equal rights?
Well, okay.
I mean, is that truly become established yet?
Well, no. We like to pretend that it's absolutely
right,
true.
Right.
Yes, yes. We don't talk about it. I mean, it will be the most vulnerable.
Yeah, maybe we'll. I intend to take over this hotel and keep the women stashed on the 7th floor. So that's just my personal technique.
You just made a lot of friends here, Paul.
If you get a chance, read Moon is a Harsh Mistress by Robert Heinlein.
Oh, yeah.
It is phenomenal, but basically it's based on the premise that if something is scarce, it's more valuable. So
right.
Women are scarce, and they control everything
that would
in society.
Be great. That would be great.
Phenomenal book, and that is one way that it could come up because everyone protects them because they are the most valuable resource.
Now, to kind of answer your question, I don't know if any of you guys were here, but I did some talks on the space track last night on reproduction in space and actually sex in space. And if you look at the reproduction side of it, you know, your best analog is primates, right? You know, female primates do have some power in primate troops, but it's always the dominant male that has the most power. And what is the other thing that happens with the dominant male? He predominates and hoards the females, doesn't allow lesser males to mate with them. So you would probably have some type of harem system, you know, that you would have dominant males and then you would have, you know, the dominant females would be bonded with them.
I have a little bit of a disagreement, because here in the United States, and we tend to forget this because this is also, sorry, it's not politically correct,
yeah.
One of the great equalizers for the weak not being beat up by the strong is called a gun. And I think that those will be very readily available, and I think that initially in the first 4 years, all the crazy people will probably take themselves out that survived that way. But reasonable people are not going to allow themselves to be abused by the stronger because they've got that great equalizer. And in societies where you see a lot of this happening, they don't have access to that great equalizer. And you know, as a skinny, balding, middle-aged man who was always not the football player, you know, in a civilized society, the rules kind of keep it. But in an uncivilized society, I would be the equal of anybody else if I knew how to use the weapons at hand. So I'm not advocating, you know, the Wild West, but I am saying that there is another bit of that. We're not just dependent on people's physical strength these days.
And I know we could and would love to sit here all afternoon talking about this. Unfortunately, we've hit just about the end of their time. What I want everyone to do is just parting thoughts.
Yeah.
Also, if people are interested in books or additional information, how to get in touch with you. If you ask a question, please join me or have your raised hand and I acknowledge you. Join me on the right side. I have a present for you to say thanks. Handouts up here, full copy of the presentation that we were giving earlier is available by QR code. So closing thoughts, Les, and we'll work our way down the hall.
Well, you know, for me, if the civilization collapses, I will probably die of a broken heart. Because, you know, my vision for the future, and those who've been in the space track with me, is I want to see humanity go to the stars. And if civilization collapses, the capability of doing that anytime in the future that I can envision goes with it. So it would be, for me, a death of sadness if I survived the initial apocalypse. For those who are interested in what I write about and such, I do have copies of some of my books for sale because they've sold out. Most of my books sold out in the dealer's room, which is way cool. For me, I feel really good about that. I have some with me, and you can find out more about me by visiting my website, lesjohnsonauthor.com. I'm on Facebook, I have Twitter, LinkedIn, all that good stuff. So if you'd like to find out more about what I write about and the optimistic future as opposed to the apocalyptic future that I tend to focus on in what I do, I'd love to hear from you, and I like to hear from folks.
Yeah, and I'm sorry, I got a jet, I got an airplane, I got to try to run and catch. My wife's already at the door waiting for me to go. But if I had to tell you, you know, for the apocalypse, two things: get your vaccinations, breastfeed. All right, seriously, food supply passes on antibodies. Breastfeeding is the most fantastic thing in the world, and vaccinations, breastfeed. I don't know.
That's
awesome.
If you guys ever have a question, Sable Hawk, SABLEHAWK. At Sablehawk, just tweet me, send me an email, hawk@madscientist.net. Okay? I will answer radiation questions. In the future, hopefully, we have a non-apocalyptic future. If we do have trouble, work on keeping the power on, work on keeping the hospitals going, keep civil society going as best possible. However, it needs to be done. Now, admittedly, some of that's going to be watch strangers. You got to be a little more careful about disease vectors, i.e. strangers wandering in. You got to watch, you know, those nice people who are coming. Maybe they're bad actors. You have to stop playing silly society. You actually have to start taking responsibility for your life, the life of your friends and family. You got to grow up. And there's a lot of people going to die quick in that circumstance because growing up is more painful to them than learning to use a gun. But it's assume the people in this room and people you know and love, you take care of them, and you learn to be an adult. And hopefully, 10 years later,
you're back to some reasonable functioning civilization, and we get back on the road where we took a short detour for whatever reason.
So we can go to the star.
So we can go to the star. Space 2050 is up in 30 minutes over on the space panel. If you really want to jog all the way down to the hill, I know I don't, but I'm going to go get on my backpack and jog down there, and we're hopefully going to say something very positive and futuristic and uplifting about space in 2050.
Thank you all for coming out. Please join us again next year. Don't forget to vote for Brad and have you here so we'll know what to bring back next year. Thank you all.